Hi everyone, I'm Rhys and welcome back to the channel. So in one of my earlier videos I talked about importing some stuff from Yahoo Auctions Japan. I showed off some of my pickups at the time. One thing that didn't feature in that video, because I've had it quite a long time and not really done anything with, was my Puckman arcade PCB. So I thought I'd put a video together just showing what it was all about, how it works, and how I got it hooked up, and finally take an opportunity to see if it works. But what's this Puckman thing all about anyway? Well, when the game was first released in Japan in July 1980, the game was known as Pac-Man, taken from the Japanese word paku, meaning to chomp. When gearing up for the English language release, it was decided that the joke would be lost on Western audiences, and so Namco decided to rename the character Puckman, due to his resemblance to a hockey puck. It was only when the cabinet started to hit American shores in December of that year that the problems really started. Problems in the form of young miscreants modifying the game's marquee to make it spell something else entirely. It was decided that it would be best all round to change the name to Pac-Man, which was closer phonetically to the original Japanese name anyway. Now what I have here is a Puckman board. The name Puckman appears on the title screen and also on the instruction cards that I got with it. So I think it's quite an interesting piece of history. So we'll just take a quick look at these. These are the original leaflets and would have been stuck to the side of the machine to explain how the game actually works. As you can see, this one has the original Puckman name in English. The next section just explains how many points and lives we get and that we get a bonus life at 10,000 points. These things are actually all configurable by the arcade operator, as I'll explain in a minute. I love the hand-drawn artwork on this one. Get higher points fighting with monsters. Make double points by continuous bites. And of course it shows how to walk through the other side through the tunnels and so on. Of course we all know how Pac-Man works by now, but it would have been a really novel thing back in those days. And then there's the bottom section, of course, about all of the bonus fruits. My PCB also came with this Japanese version of the leaflet. As you can see, it has the original Pac-Man name across the top. Other than that, it's all pretty much the same, apart from the prices on the bottom. 100 yen for a one-player game, or 200 yen for two players. Just while we're on the subject of the paperwork, my PCB also came with this rather badly photocopied page from the original manual. It's still interesting to look at, though. It shows the wiring for the edge connector, which I'll go into in a second. It has some notes on how the game can be configured by the arcade operator, and it also explains the dip switches, which I'll also go into shortly. The date on here is 1980, which would make this an early version. Onto the PCB itself. Now, when this thing first arrived, it was absolutely filthy, so I decided to give it a good clean first. You could definitely tell that it had seen some action over the years. And of course, to give it the best chance of working, I cleaned the edge connectors with a magic eraser and some IPA as well. On the subject of the edge connectors, this one may look like a standard jammer connector, but it actually predates jammer by quite a few years and is wired slightly differently. Now this board must have been installed into a jammer cabinet at some point because it came with this handmade adapter. As far as I can tell, this connector on this side was just used for testing the board at the factory. Perhaps the most immediately obvious thing about this board is the fact that it consists of two separate PCBs connected by a ribbon cable. Now the reason for this is that the original run of Puckman arcade PCBs were enormous, and arcade operators complained that they were unwieldy and difficult to handle, so later revisions like this one were split into two separate PCBs just to make them a bit smaller. Just having a look around the top PCB, we have some power regulation and timing circuitry in this corner, as well as the dip switches. Later arcade games would store their configuration in battery-backed RAM or even flash memory, but in early games like this, the arcade operator could configure the game by flipping these small toggle switches. These determine things like how many credits are needed for a game, whether the game is in free play mode, how many lives the player will get per game, and in the case of Pac-Man, how many points are needed for the bonus lives, so it's pretty configurable. Moving along, this big IC is the CPU, which is an NEC D760C. It's a clone of the ubiquitous Zilog Z80, which was famously used in the Amstrad CPC, TRS-80, Sinclair machines like the ZX80, 81 and Spectrum, and of course the MSX computers, which were huge in Japan. On the gaming side of things, it was also used as the CPU in the Sega Master System and as a co-processor in the Mega Drive and the Neo Geo AES. This is before we even get started on all of the arcade machines that used it either as the main CPU or doing audio duty, so it's definitely something you will have come across at some point or other. These numbered chips are NEC D2716 16K EEPROMs. There are 8 here and there are 4 on the bottom PCB, making for a total of 192K. With most arcade games, these are split in such a way that certain sprites will be on one, the mazes on another, in-game text on another, attract screens on yet another, and so on, making it relatively easy to diagnose a ROM fault and swap in the correct replacement. It's also possible to add hacks or enhancements or new game modes or even run an entirely different game just by reprogramming these EEPROMs. In fact, Miss Pac-Man started off as an illicit hack for the original Pac-Man boards, but that's a story for another time. So this chip is a PROM, which is like an EEPROM, but can only be programmed once. The game board has four of these, and this is one of the two that determine the colours of the maze and of Pac-Man himself. I'm really intrigued as to why these weren't part of the main ROMs, but haven't been able to dig that info up, so if you do, please pass that on in the comments, because I'd be very interested to know. Now if we turn around to the underside of the board, we can see our four remaining game EPROMs, our other colour PROM, and two more PROMs, which are where our sound effects are stored. Other than that, we just have a load of 7400 series TTL chips, which are just common basic logic for moving bits around. So let's get this thing hooked up! Now of course, this was originally intended to live inside an arcade machine, so to connect it to a standard TV we'll need this. Now this is a device called a Supergun, and what it does is it uses an industry standard jammer edge connector, connects to the arcade PCB, and it pipes the audio and video out to a standard SCART connector, as well as providing power for the board of course. It also adds two Neo Geo AES joystick connectors, and it just so happens that I have a Neo Geo AES joystick here as well. So that's pretty much everything we need to get going. You may also notice that I've turned my monitor sideways. Now this is known as tatay mode, which is the Japanese word for vertical, and the reason essentially being that monitors aren't perfectly square of course, so if you have a game which needs more vertical than horizontal space, the easiest way to do it is to just turn the monitor around. And most Japanese candy cabs actually have a mechanism built in that makes it very easy for the arcade operator to do this. So just get everything plugged in, it should only take a second. So after a quick self-test, the board's all up and running, and the first thing we notice of course is that we have the original Japanese names for the ghosts. I'll have a crack at these, although my pronunciation will no doubt be terrible. So we have Oikake, meaning the chaser, Machibuse is the ambusher, Kimigore is fickle, apparently, and Otoboke means feigned ignorance. The second part refers to their colour, well, apart from the poor orange guy here, I'm not quite sure what he did to deserve that. Then the game goes into the attract mode that we all know and love. There isn't any sound at this point, of course. So if I just insert a credit by pressing the select button on the joystick, we'll see the Puckman name come up. Now I'm by no means an expert at Pac-Man, but I want to at least complete level 2 to see if the animations are there, so I'll give it a go. This game was designed for a 4-way joystick, while I'm using an 8-way joystick as well, so I'm just getting some professional excuses out there early. So there you have it. I suck at Pac-Man. Wait, no, that's not what the video was supposed to be about, was it? So I hope this has been an interesting look into the history of the game and how the arcade PCB works, and obviously how you can get one hooked up at home. If you found the video educational and or entertaining, please hit that like button. I'd very much appreciate it. I always have retro computing and retro gaming projects on the go, so if that sounds like the kind of thing that interests you and you haven't subscribed to my channel already, I'd really appreciate it if you hit that subscribe button. I just finally want to say thank you to everyone for watching. I'll catch you down in the comments and hopefully see you soon.